Welcome.
Let me start by greeting you all with the greeting of Islam and the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum. My paper entitled is The Islamization of Democracy, the political requisite of democracy in the Muslim world. The purpose of my paper is twofold. The first is to discuss, hopefully, in a gathering like this, the conceptual problem of democracy. Let's face it. We need to engage in intellectual discussion of what's democracy and what do we mean by democratization. And the second one is to talk about the seven, what I would call, requisite for democracy in order to succeed in the Muslim world. Let me start with the first issue or the first concept. Hopefully my paper will be a bridge to what Professor Sullivan said, the tale of two cities in Egypt, from Fayyum to Alexandria. To start with, let's agree, or at least I will assume that we will agree, that there is a dispute about what constitutes democracy. Regardless of how attractive it is, how important it is, but literally speaking, it means rule of the people, isn't it? But since I teach political science in America, let me just mention a few examples of how democracy came to the stage that we are in today. Let me start with what I call the first modern political scientist in America, James Madison, when he wrote one of his best articles, Federalist Number 10, in where you will find only democracy mentioned. There is no mentioning by the founders of this nation of the concept of democracy, except in that document. As far as I know, I'm not an expert in American politics, it is comparative politics. But from my own reading, that there is no mentioning in the literature of the founders of this nation, except in the Federalist, which is the best article, by the way. We call it Federalist, by the way. He described democracy as the worst system. And let me just quote him. He said, they were ever being found incompatible with personal securities and rights of property, and have ever in general been as short in their lives as they have been violent in their death. 75 years later, I'm not accurate in numbers, but in 1863, a great American president came, his name Lincoln, and he delivered a speech in Ginsburg, should we call it Ginsburg speech in 1863, in where he defined democracy as a democracy, a government of the people, by the people, from the people. Do you notice that in 1863, we were in the midst of the war? Another way, 13 other states decided to secede, and Lincoln himself told them, come back or do something else. And we forced them to join the Union or rejoin the Union. Let me go another example, or give you another example, just to show you that it is really not accurate. That's why we need to spend some time. What do we mean by democracy? And for those who are watching Iraq, you can see that we are still in the stage of what constitutes democracy is. Winston Churchill, 85 years later, he said it is the worst system of governing, except for the alternative. But let me end by another political scientist, which is Robert Dole, who wrote one of his best speeches in Polarchy. And he described the procedural democracy. He mentioned list of conditions, what constitute democracy and how democracy should succeed. How I define democracy based on all of this? Let me just define democracy as a political system which is based on choice, competition, respect for human rights, and the rule of law. And democratization is the process which can take us from non-democratic or dictatorial regime to a democratic system. Another way, when we talk about democratization, we talk about process. When we talk about democracy, we talk about certain values, certain principles that we have to have in order to call that system democracy, which means that we might have different democracy. That's why in the Islamic country, we need to Islamize democracy. And what takes to Islamize democracy? Let me suggest to you some component, what I call them requisite or conditions. And hopefully we will discuss them, because of the sake of time, I will just mention them. And I will give you just one example in each. The first requisite, I think, choice, freedom to choose. There is no substitute for choice in the Muslim country. It is the fundamental principle. There is no Islam without choice, to me. The first God asked people to choose, isn't it? So that there is no choice. If there is no choice, there is no freedom. And when I mean by choice, because for the sake of time, as I said, I will not elaborate, we mean the two wings of choice, civil liberty and civil rights. Freedom from government and freedom to government or for government to protect us. That's what we need. It's not just civil liberty alone. It is not no to government alone. We want government to protect us too. We want government to protect the poor, to protect the needy, and to protect the minorities. And all of us can live together. What we call them in political science, negative rights and positive rights. The second one is the constitutionalism. As we all know, I'm sure, that the main characteristics of democracy and democratization is a written formal constitution. That's what we need. We need the government of laws, not men. We need to refer to the laws. We need to be protected. The beauty about this government, the United States of America, that nobody is above the law. I will never get this chance to be in this great university that I'm teaching in today, unfortunately, in any Islamic country. But that's what we need in the Muslim countries too. What that required, too many things, but let me mention three important things. What I will call the supremacy of Sharia and the rule of law. The supremacy of Sharia and the rule of law. What I mean by Sharia, the fundamental principles and value of Islam. Al-halal ubayyin wal-haram ubayyin, the Rasul said. Anything else is subject to interpretation, and even the fundamentals, we can argue about what they mean. What they mean is up to us in many ways. So the supremacy of Sharia and the rule of law is essential, and I'm willing to elaborate on this concept if I have a chance to. Another way, it is not, I'm not arguing for Islam is the solution or the hal, al-Islam huwa al-hal. I'm arguing that no laws should contradict these values and principles. Anything else goes. Al-asal fil ashya libaha. Islam said, Al-asal fil ashya libaha. Everything is allowed unless it's contradicting the fundamental principle of Islam. And for the sake of time, if I have a chance, I'll come back if you think that. The third one is the creation or creating competition. And that's where I agree with Robert Dole. Dole, by the way, not the formal majority ruler, majority of the Senate, the Republican great leader. I'm talking about Robert Dole, D-A-H-L, great modern political scientist. I'm sure some of you know him, but he's a great leader, intellectual in America, and he contributed tremendously to the intellectual heritage of America, especially politically. So we have to have election. We have to have free and fair election. We cannot use fear as a measurement. So I always say that the Islamists are here and democracy is inevitable. We have to allow people to choose whoever they want to. And that's where, as long as we have a mechanism, as long as we have a constitution, As long as we have a process, we cannot have it both ways. We cannot tell people to do what we say, not what we do. It is very, very important to have our credibility intact, to have our credential trusted. The fourth one is building a strong institution. Unfortunately, in the Arab world, there is no institution but the military, modern institution but the military. That's why I'm going to come back to us when we talk about this. We need more institutions, strong institutions, political parties, interest groups, institutes like this one, all of the other institutions which can contribute to the democratic process. Otherwise, we will never succeed. I hope I still have time. The fifth one is solving the political crisis. And this is what my dear friend called, I wrote my dissertation in the crisis of political leadership in the Arab countries and process of publishing it. What I concluded, my theory in political leadership, that leaders have to meet three necessary requirements, but they don't have to be sufficient. And they are another way, they are sufficient but necessary requirement. They have to be legitimate, they have to be accountable, and they have to be credible. These are the three necessary but not sufficient requirements for leadership. And that's what we are missing based on what I did from 1970 to 1990. None of the Arab rulers, with all due respect to them, maybe they are great in many other things, but none of them succeeded or were qualified, except al-Mahdi, the ruler of Sudan, which was overthrown for a while. He was a marginal leader in many ways. And that's why we need to have leaders. Our community, our regions we have absence of leaders. I'm talking here about political leadership. And it is essential to, Stevenson said, one of the American historians said, history is a history of men, history of presidents. Actually, when we talk about American history, what we are talking about? George Washington, Jackson, Lincoln, Roosevelt, Kennedy, Clinton, Bush. So what we are talking about is history are written by men, and women, of course. See what I'm saying? But mainly men, and mainly president, people in power in another way. History are the history of the winners, more or less in another way. In another way, that's why it is essential to create and build and organize and train leaders who can lead that community. We cannot succeed without leaders. We have too much talk and no action. And that's one of the problems of democracy. We talk too much and we don't listen to each other, I think. See what I'm saying? We need to let our actions speak for themselves, not what we say. Doesn't matter what we say. We are not in celebrity contest here. That's why we need to make sure that we have leaders who can. There is a difference between recognizing you as a leader and claiming yourself a leader. And that's what we have in the Arab countries. In my countries, which I will not mention its name, our leaders put his picture everywhere. Everything he said was written on the walls. Everywhere you look, you see his statement. But none of what he said, I challenge him to apply 60% of what he said. Or 10% of what he said. That's our problem in the Muslim countries, especially since I am an Arab originally, in the Arab countries. And that's what we need to have. I hope we still have time. But my sixth is the militarization of the army. We have 20 military coups in the Arab countries between 1970 to 1990. They ruled 10 countries. None of them established any democratic or modern country, even if it's not democratic, like Singapore or whatever, you know. None of them. Isn't that strange? That's why we need to take the military out of politics. In Britain, since 1700, the military never intervened because they had small coup d'etat led by Cromwell for 12 years maybe. they said never again, and they relied on the Navy to make sure that the military will not come. In the Arab countries, all the military barricades and bases are in the middle of the capital, one block from the TV station or radio station. Isn't that strange? When you go to Egypt, for all the, I love Egypt, I go to Egypt a lot of times, they have even the secret base. Even the bus station will tell you, this is the secret base. Isn't that strange? You don't come to America. Have you seen any military base in America? No, even if they are there. See what I'm saying? In America, they intervene only one time because the interest of the nation was at stake in the Civil War. See what I'm saying? And even when Eisenhower warned the country from the military complex or the industrial military complex, he was not afraid that the military will take that. That's why, and I mentioned many things, seven reasons or six reasons to... Do I still
have time? Two, 3 minutes.
Okay. To legitimize the civilian control, to strengthen the political institution, and to form a rival militaries. Like in America, they have four armies, actually, not just one. In Britain, you know, that's why we need to make sure and to depoliticize the military. Military should not run for office. They should not play politics. And they should be out of politics, period. It should be another way. We should not have ideology in the militaries. They are there to protect the interests of the country and to fight for the interests of the country, not to be Baptist or communist or atheist or socialist or whatever. I'm speaking too fast with heavy accents, so if you cannot understand what I'm saying, just forgive me. And the last thing, eliminating or minimizing the external influence. It is very, very clear that America, if they want to help the Muslim world or countries, they have to understand this concept. There are lots of people who look to the negative side to things, and rightfully so. And we have to do it right in America if we want to export democracy, as we said. And I think it is very, very essential to work in this concept. As I told you, let me end by just emphasizing that the Muslims or the Islamists, by the Islamists I mean the activist Muslims who are working to establish a modern democratic state. I think the Islamists are here to stay. And democracy, there is no alternative for democracy, and we have to merge them. Thank you for listening. I am so glad to be here.
Thank you, Mohammed. We go now, Radwan, how much time do we have? We go to our, what I hope will be our question period. And that we will not adopt the Fayyum model here of additional speeches to maintain my theme. Having said that, let me exercise the moderator's privilege and make two very short remarks. The first one is that I think there is some very good news out there. I teach every summer Arab students from the Middle East, and over many years now, but especially in recent years, I've been impressed by the intelligent criticism of these students of extant regimes, the tremendous desire on the part of young people for liberal and democratic systems, and their determination to understand the United States, to come to terms with the realities of the world in the context of democracy, limitation of governmental power, and individual liberty. On the note of individual liberty and the limitation of governmental power, I think all of our speakers here touched on these themes today, and I assume somewhere in the audience we're honored and distinguished to have with us this morning one of the truly great classical, I use my words carefully, classical liberals and cultural traditionalists at the same time. And I hope all of you who are interested in these themes will make an attempt to get to know him and talk with him. Anas, I think you would be particularly interested in doing so if you don't know him already, the very distinguished Professor Leonard Liggio, who has spent a lifetime working on these issues. So Leonard is somewhere with us, and I do hope, Leonard, thank you very much. I do hope that you will make an effort to get to know him and chat with him. Sir, our first question.
Yes, Abdul Wahab Al-Kibsi with the National Endowment for Democracy. Let me just very quickly with Dr. Barween, just don't know where to start. I hope we can have more time later to discuss all the issues you opened up. Just so many disagreements and so many questions that I have. Maybe we can have a much longer session, but just one theme that you brought up is when you mix rule of law and supremacy of Sharia just so openly like that without discussing it further, whose Sharia, whose interpretation, where, how, it's just too deep for us to discuss at this time. But I'll go back to Dr. Ottaway. No, it's not a political statement. It's not a political statement at all. I'm serious about this. We need to discuss this much deeper than that. We can't just throw it there like a bomb and just run away from it. Dr. Ottaway, you promised us signs of the crisis, causes of the crisis, and then can there be a turnaround? Excellent presentation. Thank you very much. I learned a lot from it. My only, I'm only disturbed by there was no, can there be a turnaround? You ended the last session by adding some more causes and signs without answering your own question. I hope you can elaborate a little bit on that. And thank you very much. Excellent session, by the way. Thanks.
Yes, Mohammed, do you want to?
I never thought that I'm a guerrilla fighter throwing things. No, it's a really great point. I really thank you for raising it, and I am not raising these issues just for feel good politics. I don't believe in feel politics, and I believe in continuation the discussion. We need to engage in discussion. We need to build the bridges. We need to the dialogue of civilization, not the clash of civilization, like the great Professor Huntington said. It is essential to work together, and I'm willing to elaborate. I said that this concept needs lecture by itself, but I'm willing to discuss it. The supremacy means that the values and the principle that what the Rasul said, it's there al halal al haram, ubayy another way, that there are this is the fundamental, the values, the principle. And even within this context, it can be subject to interpretation. And that's what I mean by the supremacy. In other way, there are certain things in the Constitution of America are not subject to amendments. For example, you cannot amend the number of the Senate of America, because it is part of the Constitution. So there are certain clauses in the Constitution where you cannot amend them. It is part of America itself. And that's why we need to focus on the things that, what are the things that which classify you as a Muslim. Otherwise, you will never be, will not become a Muslim nation. And I'm saying, as I said, I'm willing to discuss it more. If you have any other interpretation, I'll accommodate that. I say what I say, not to, I assume that I am right, but anybody who will convince me otherwise, I will be more.
Marina Ottaway. Who is a senior associate in the Democracy and Rule of Law Project, which is dedicated to analysis of the state of democracy around the world and the involvement of the United States in efforts to promote democracy. I recommend to you her latest book, entitled Uncharted Journey, Democracy Promotion in the Middle East, which she co-edited with Thomas Carruthers, and was published in January 2005. And I won't go through with you this morning the lengthy list of her other writings, except to add that she is a lecturer in African studies at the NHTSA School for Advanced International Studies at Johns Hopkins, and she has taught at a variety of universities overseas, including the AUC, the American University in Cairo. So, Marina, please.
I think it's good morning, first of all, but I think it's extremely appropriate, and I don't think Mr. Sullivan knew how appropriate it was, to pick an Italian to be between Arab time and American time. I think it could not have been a better choice. People in between. Mm-hmm.